meeting will come to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. Our first item is the approval of the agenda.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda as printed.
Second.
Motion by Treacle, second by Singwald. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. We have no public comment tonight, so next we have our consent agenda. The consent agenda is made up of routine business items that can be acted upon with one motion. If any board member wishes to discuss an item, they may request that it be pulled from the consent agenda and it will be acted upon separately. Does anyone have an item they wish to discuss? I'll take a motion.
Make a motion to approve the above consent agenda.
Second.
Motion by Saucer, second by Cordes. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. We'll move right into administrative action tonight, and our first item is the approval of health savings account plan. Ms. Mary Ann Thomas.
Thank you, Board Chair, members of the board, community, Superintendent Haugen. You have before you tonight a recommendation that we implement a health savings account for our employees that are on our high deductible Plan C medical insurance plan. This health savings account would allow employees on that plan to put away pre-tax dollars into their own health savings account that we deduct from their payroll check, so it makes it nice and easy. And then they can use that money for reimbursing themselves for medical expenses that they or their family members incur. Once they contribute the money to the health savings account plan, it's theirs. They keep it. It can grow. It can be there forever. And so it's really a nice way for them to be able to pay for unreimbursed medical expenses, because if they are on that high deductible Plan C, they can't participate in our annual flex spending account, so they don't have a way to pay for medical expenses on a pre-tax basis. We do want employees to learn more about that high deductible plan. Last year, we only had 6 employees on the plan, and through a lot of education and explaining to employees the difference between our 3 plans, we now have 50 employees on that plan. So although right now we would only be offering this to employees who are non-union, the resolution before you would give unionized employees the option to bargain that, their participation, and there would be no reason we wouldn't want them to participate as well. So I'm sure many of you probably have health savings accounts and high deductible plans. You're probably more familiar with this than I am. But I would be happy to answer any questions that you have. Otherwise, you have the recommendation for the resolution in your board packet.
Are there any questions?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Now, this is the employees putting their own money in. We're not putting money in on top of anything, right?
Correct.
So, okay.
Yep. It's employee contributions only.
Thank you.
Other questions? Then I'll take a motion.
I make a motion to approve, effective September 3rd, 2013, a district health savings account plan for eligible employees enrolled in the district's high deductible health insurance plan, and that associated contributions and expenses be paid by the employee through payroll deduction.
A second.
Motion by Beam, second by Saucer. Any discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Beam?
Yes.
Cordes?
Yes.
Saucer?
Aye.
Singwald?
Yes.
Treacle?
Yes.
Lee?
Yes. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, we have our approval of the resolution providing for the sale of the general obligation aid anticipation certificates of indebtedness. Mr. Carl Kohlmark. It's a mouthful.
It is. Thank you, Madam Chair, Superintendent, School Board members. We've brought to you this evening a resolution authorizing the sale of $11.3 million of general obligation aid anticipation certificates. Now, this is in order to prevent our cash from going into a deficit position. The good news is a year ago we borrowed $15 million, so this is almost $4 million less. If you probably kept up with some of the legislative activity in the past, you'll notice that the state was holding back in excess of 30% of state aids. Recent legislative action now has brought that down to 10%. Previously, I had anticipated as much as $6 million benefit from this particular legislative action, but nevertheless, the way all of the metered payments are set up, it looks like the reduction is going to be closer to $4 million. The good news is Ehlers and Associates had been projecting a 0.75% interest rate on this short-term borrowing in the last 1 year. The information that they provided to me this evening is Recori just opened up their sale or awarded their sale, and they came in at under 0.5%. So hopefully we'll get the same kind of rates. You do have a cash flow schedule included in your agenda material if you're curious what those what that cash flow looks like through that through the next 12-month period. And I think with that, I'd like to ask if you have any questions. Otherwise, we would come back to you on September 9th with results of the sale and asking for a school board awarding of the sale.
Are there any questions? And I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to adopt the resolution providing for the sale of 11,300,000 GOA anticipation certificates series 2013B as presented.
I'll second it.
Motion by Cordes, second by Singwald. Any discussion? Excuse me. Roll call vote, please.
Thieb?
Yes.
Cordes?
Yes.
Sasser?
Yes.
Singwald?
Yes.
Treacle?
Yes.
Thieb?
Yes. Motion carries. Next, we have our work session discussion topics, and our first item is the Minnesota legislative funding changes and referendum options.
Thank you again, Madam Chair, Superintendent, board members. You have in your material a little bit of information that I pulled together, not with the intent to give you every small tidbit of revenue sources. What I wanted to do is to try and, you know, paint for you a picture of the major revenue items that the legislature approved and the impact that we'll see in our general fund for fiscal year 13-14 and 14-15. The easy part of this is for fiscal 2013-14, there are two elements that are impacting our budget, both of which have already been incorporated in the budget that you adopted in June. First of all, the general education basic revenue formula increased by 1.5% or $78 per pupil. That will generate a little over $600,000. The other element that was changed in the formulas, and it's a very complex changeover in the whole special education funding formula. I probably should have put some backslashes in this schedule because there are three different formulas in special education: the special education formula, the cross subsidy aid formula, and excess cost formula. What they were trying to do, and if it was really a simplified formula, I'd lay it out here for you. They were trying to simplify the formula. I'm not convinced that they did much in terms of simplification. But they also were doing some things trying to augment the cross-subsidy aid and excess cost formulas to try and approach more full funding of the special education program. Now, we're a couple $1 million that the general fund subsidizes their special education programs. So in this particular case for fiscal 2013-14, we'll be picking up an additional $100,000+. Every bit helps, but as you can tell, it's still got a ways to go before they fully fund special education. As I pointed out earlier, both of these sources of revenue were built into the revenue in the budget that you adopted. Just a reminder, the expenditures went up as well. We had about a $612,000 increase in our staff development expenditures. And if you recall, when you adopted the budget, I told you that there was kind of an offset with some new expenditures also by virtue of the legislature. That's kind of a side note on expenditures, but I just didn't want anybody to think, boy, we should be looking a lot better this year than we are, and that's not the case. What really gets to be a profound change in what's happening in 2014-15, there are two simple pieces to explain. Number one, the general ed basic formula goes up 1.5% or $78 per pupil again. That will generate $573,000 more revenue to us, increase over 2013-14. Now, as you look at that, you might say, well, if we're getting another $78, why is the revenue less than the year before? It's because the projected enrollment is less. Okay, that's the only reason why that was down. If the enrollment was static, you'd see the same number that was in 13-14. Again, some further augmentation of the special education regular formula, cross-subsidy aid formula, and excess cost formula, an increase of $255,000. So over 2 years, you've got almost $400,000 of new special education revenue. Again, we appreciate the support from the legislature in helping us address the subsidies to special education. What I really wanted to highlight this evening for you with regard to 14-15 are some things that you will start to hear more about over the coming months when we go through the property tax levy process, and that is there are some options. The legislature enacted this new form of revenue called location equity revenue. I mistitled it here. I called it local equity revenue. But the location equity revenue is $424 per pupil that you have the option to allow that to be reduced from your current projected referendum operating revenue of $713 per pupil. By virtue of that $424 of location equity revenue, if you pull that off the referendum levy, that in effect causes the other form of revenue called equity revenue to go up. There's an interesting dynamic that when your referendum levy goes down, your equity revenue goes up. In this particular case, this location equity revenue is subtracted off the $713 our current general education, our current referendum operating levy per pupil. If you reduce that, that becomes a new form of revenue equalized from the state. And we would then see an increase in the other revenue called equity revenue. I know this is very complicated. I'm going to try and take you step by step through this. Starting out with a $713.93 per pupil voter-approved referendum, if you reduce the local equity revenue $424, that would mean that you have remaining as voter-approved referendum $289.93 per pupil. There's also, that means that going forward, if you had to renew your referendum in 2017, November 2017, you would then have on the books $289.93 to ask voter approval. They then took one further step, and it's called converting up to $300 of voter-approved referendum levies, converting it from voter-approved to school board-approved. And that particular mechanism means that each year the school board would have to decide whether you want to support that $300 in the tax levy for the next year. Bottom line is, if you receive the location equity revenue of $424 and convert the $300 per pupil, you would then have zero voter approved referendum levy. Now, there are three possible things that could happen. I refer to it as option one. If you do not like the notion of the location equity revenue, you would need to opt out by the end of August. September 1st actually is the date in statute. If you opt out, then your maximum revenue that you would receive through these legislative changes in 14-15 is estimated at $16,000. If you do nothing by September 1st, you then automatically will benefit from the location equity revenue. That would generate an estimated $270,000 of revenue for fiscal 14-15. Now let's assume that you allow that to happen, and then before the end of September, you convert that remaining $300 of referendum levy from voter approved to school board approved. The total revenue then, combination of the equity revenue impact and the conversion of $300, would be an estimated increased revenue of $341,000. In any one of those cases, there are property tax savings. If you opt out of the location equity revenue, the projected property tax relief in taxes payable 2014 would be a little over $800,000. If you don't opt out, the property tax reduction is estimated at $635,000. Now, if you don't opt out and convert, the property tax relief is estimated at $611,000. So there are some things to think about here. But you look at the bottom of that schedule, you have a choice of revenues going up anywhere from $846,000 to almost $1.2 million. The other thing I want to point out is I have not incorporated into any of these numbers the potential revenue from kindergarten. That's another topic that we'll be talking about a little bit later. That's based on how many pupil units will generate their revenue for that program, but they are not included in this total revenue estimate. I'm just trying to think if there's anything else that I want to share with you. I do want to turn over and try to answer questions. If you recall, and I share your frustration, at the June board meeting, we brought a resolution forward about whether we wanted to hold open that door for a referendum levy. And the legislature had done their work, they had done some analysis, but there are quite a few schedules attached to here. If you've had an opportunity to look at them, we don't have these tools, we don't have this. This wasn't available until that meeting in June. So I apologize that we couldn't provide it earlier, but we do have that information. You do have some time, but we do as an administration need to know if you are planning to do the opt-out for that location equity revenue, because that would need to take place at the next school board meeting. As an administration, I would suggest that we would be coming to you with option number three. Obviously, though, that's going to take inaction on one part and then action converting the $300 per pupil conversion of referendum levy sometime in September. So I think with that, I don't know, Superintendent, if you have any thoughts, observations?
Well, thank you. I think that was terrific. It's a very complex topic, and I think it's about as clear as it can be. I can tell you that I was at the superintendent conference last week where the architect of this, Tom Melcher from the state, really talked a lot about it, and it is a significant change in Minnesota and something that all these groups we belong to have tried for a long time to get this kind of equity, to get this decrease in property taxes while still bringing increases to schools and making it more equitable, because schools that don't have big levies now actually get some dollars. And there's a nice closing of the gap from, I don't remember the amount, it's like 35% difference between the highest and lowest down to like 24% difference. So it really does what it's meant to. He just made it really, really clear over and over that this was meant to be used by school boards and school districts. This was really meant to happen. The legislature, when they put this in place, expected virtually everyone to do it. But the exceptions that he said might be schools that are going to run huge bond or big levies, because they might be packaging it all that way. And instead, so the only schools he would expect that don't do both and take option three are ones who maybe have a big building bond coming up, or maybe a big levy coming up. And you'll see some of those where they're trying to decide. And they take a look at the numbers and see which is the best way for their school district. But for us, it actually maybe puts off the concern about having, you know, a levy, and actually puts off levies wear you out. And they're hard on your community and they're hard on you. And the fact that we have another one coming up that's just a renewal is just a, you know, this is, does away with that. So there's a lot of good things about this. And the more I've learned about it, this was like written for us. It was like they had us in mind when they wrote this legislation. So.
Thoughts?
Are there questions?
Yeah. So I'm looking at that front schedule in that packet. How do you get to the total option one, option two, option three?
With option one, I take the general ed basic revenue and the special ed revenue in the option one square. Okay. And then I, in all three scenarios, I take the top two squares, and then I just plug in either option one, two, or three.
Can you, can you explain the 424 and the 300 again, in how it relates to what the 713 that we have, that's built in for the 14-15 year, because I think it's only six something this year, if I remember correctly.
Correct. The $713 is based on the inflationary factors that the State Department has on their website for anticipated growth in the per pupil referendum amount. Okay, so they're looking at that based on what that number would be in 2000, payable 2014. Now, are you looking for just taking that starting point and working down as far as?
Because you mentioned 424 of the, it was the local equity. Revenue, right?
Location equity revenue.
Location equity revenue. And that would automatically replace unless we opt out? Is that?
That would, if you don't opt out, that will automatically reduce that per pupil amount from 713 down to about $290 per pupil.
Okay. And then
it's no longer a referendum amount that's subtracted out.
Okay. So that's automatically going to happen unless we opt out?
Correct.
Okay. And then. In option three, you're looking at, we have that option to have a board-approved referendum that replaces
correct.
That 289 and adds $11.
Correct.
And we still reduce taxes paid in our area by $611,000.
Correct.
Okay. I think I'm with it.
Perfect.
Now.
Other questions?
Madam Chair. Are there any, is any possibility that the legislature could change the structure if we were to opt in and do the conversion options, that it might be taken away?
You know, anything's possible. I don't see that happening. I think it was a concerted effort to, as the superintendent pointed out, to try and equalize and make this sort of revenue available to a lot more districts, make it more fair. I don't see that happening. I do think there's a potential risk that if you opt out, that opportunity might evaporate. That's part of the reason why I would argue that don't opt out, go with flow.
Are there other questions?
So can you explain again the difference between option two and option three? So both of those, you opt out of the local equity revenue. One of them is not converting the 300. One of them is converting the 300. How do we get to those amounts again?
Well, I think you just answered that. Option two is the revenue that we'd received by simply not opting out of the location equity revenue. The additional 70-some thousand dollars would be a combination of not opting out plus converting that
okay.
remaining $300.
So that basically that option two
is
that difference.
Can you speak into the mic, Laura?
The difference between, or in option two, is that difference between that 713 and the 289? Is that what that option two is picking up?
Correct.
Okay.
Madam Chair, if we were to opt in, if we were to do option three, and is it up until 2017, or is it a continuing every year process?
Right now, your referendum authority will expire in fiscal 18, I believe, meaning the November 2017 elections. You would have to hold a referendum for the $713. By not opting out, you'd then have $289 on the books that would go to the voters for renewal in 2017. If you also convert that $300, there is nothing on the books for referendum levies that are voter approved. There would be no renewals. Just also an observation you might find interesting is you would still have authority to go to the community in the future for up to about $1,600 per pupil of additional revenue. Not that you're interested in doing that, but just so that you're aware of that.
Wow.
So right now we would have to go renew our referendum in 2017, but this basically gets it so that we don't have anything to renew if we do option three.
The only thing you would be renewing, that's correct. You as a school board, though, each year has to renew the $300.
So basically, we'd be looking at, through option three, we would reduce the levy locally from $713 down to $300.
Yes, but it would have a different title. Instead of being voter approved, right, it would be board authorized.
Right, but in this case, what we're doing is we're cutting local property taxes,
yep,
by, you know, over four, about $400.
Right. It's a nice, student, clear way to say it.
That is right. That's true.
And then, but the benefit is that it becomes a fixed $300 going forward. We don't have to send, we don't have to expend a lot of money trying to go out for renewal.
Absolutely.
Okay.
How much does it cost, you know, in marketing and things to do a referendum to renew even at the same rate? I mean, do you
successfully
have, yeah.
You want to take a guess?
Wow.
What?
Yeah, well, probably there's two things. Jim said $50,000 to $100,000, and that's probably a number when you look at the whole amount. The school district's part of that might be $20,000 or something, but it's that your community, instead of supporting the school with dollars, they have to raise money to run a campaign, and then people who normally are volunteering at school now are volunteering for a campaign. So it's a big deal for your community, even a renewal. So.
And that doesn't measure the time of the school board and the administration and working on putting information together. So there are some other inherent costs as well.
Yeah.
Any last questions?
Madam Chair, I just have a comment. I struggle with taking the power away from the voters for these levies. However, I do like the fact that it would be saving taxpayers significantly, mm-hmm, and giving us a generated revenue source. So I think it's definitely something to seriously consider. I struggle with it, though.
I agree with Board Member Saucer on that, too, that I struggle with taking away that voter control, but I think when you kind of look at some of these finances, it's a pretty compelling argument to, you know, the time and energy, the money, the, you know, and everything that goes with it. So I agree with her.
Well, Madam Chair, I like the fact that we're looking at a tax cut here. Basically, we're shifting money. Actually, it's technically a net increase. But it's a shifting money to the state off of our local taxpayers, which we already have a very high tax rate in this district. And so if you take option three, we're still cutting $611,000 off the taxpayers, which I don't know what that totals out per household, but it's got to show up in the bottom line one way or the other. So I think it creates stability and reduces overall expenses down the road for us. So I think It's a win-win
option three. You're helping taxpayers and the students in the district. Did you want to add something?
There are some schedules in here. We don't need to go through them tonight, but it does give you an idea of the reduction of property taxes based on that option three on different valuations, if you get a chance to look at that.
Any last questions or comments? Thank you very much. Appreciate your time on this. Our next item is the attendance boundary process.
Madam Chair, while Jane's coming up, I neglected just before we started this, after our first guest was gone, I was going to introduce. We do have another guest with us in the audience, so if that's okay.
Sure.
And we do have Dan Pickens. He's not so much a guest as he has been a very important player with us in the school district, but he has a new role now as you know, the head of instructional technology, with Charles Dwarty taking on another new challenge in another organization. So I see Dan's here tonight and wanted to welcome him. And he should even stand up so everyone can look at him. He's all dressed very nice tonight. And, of course, we've gotten to know Dan really, really well. And so I wanted to recognize him and still give him time to take off if he needs to. So
thank you for being here. Yes.
Well, I'd just like to introduce Jane Huska. She's my partner in the finance office. I've asked Jane to spearhead the attendance area boundary change process, number one, because she's brilliant, number two, because she did participate in the committee in the process, I'm not sure how many years ago, it was 4 or 5 years. This is kind of the official kickoff, and I think Jane is going to go through and to kind of express all of the different activities and timelines and things that we're going to be experiencing back behind the scenes and with the school board over the coming months. So Jane, it's all yours.
Madam Chair, board members, Superintendent Haugen, thank you for having me tonight. We are going to start the boundary change process here in Farmington. It will hopefully take effect for the 14-15 school year. And in your board packet, you should have had a general layout of the process that we are going to be taking. It's very similar to the process that we did in 2009 when we added Riverview and the high school. So if we'll just talk about the high points as we go across. We have already met with the building principals, and we're currently working on the capacities of our buildings to ensure when we're going through the process that we fill our buildings equally amongst them. We will be working on getting the committee members together. We're looking at getting one secondary principal and two elementary principals. We're looking at getting two parents from each one of the elementary schools and one from each of the middle schools. And a board member. So if anyone, I know Laura wasn't a board member last time, but Laura was part of the process last time. So anyone that would like to be part of it, just let me know. We're hoping to have a Google Doc out there that people can submit their application of why they want to be part of the process. And hopefully we can get a broad spectrum of people from the community to represent. And so we can come out with a great balance within our schools. We'll be looking at different application softwares. Last time we used VersaTrans, and it is what our bus company uses. There is a good software or great software out there called Guide K-12 that we'll be taking a look at. We do have that software already, but we've never used it for the boundary changes, so we'll be looking at that to see if it's more user-friendly for everybody involved and hoping that it will talk to all of our systems. Mm-hmm. We want to make sure that between campus, VersaTrans, and Guide K-12, that they all work together and we are not causing more work than we need to. Well then, which you guys are well aware of, we need to be looking at our kindergarten program and how that's going to be set forth for the 14-15 school year. So as soon as you guys make some decisions on that, we can make some decisions on boundary changes.
And at this point, I'm going to add a little bit about the kindergarten program because you will be having some information presented to you on the process of establishing the all-day kindergarten program. Laura Pierce, our Director of Innovative Programs, will be joining the school board on August 26th, starting to set, you know, kind of a framework of what kind of needs we'll have from a staffing perspective, furnishings, the half-day, whether there's a half-day program and what that structure looks like. Locations, where are we going to house the all-day kindergartens? Will we have a half-day program at every location, or are we going to have that merged as part of the all-day program? Is there going to be just one site? Just to give you an example of the different decisions that will need to be made, some in things that will be reviewed with you, like classroom square footage. All of our kindergarten classrooms in all of our five elementary schools are fully being used. So looking at our projections, we're likely going to need 6 to 7 more kindergarten classrooms. We have the space. The only difference is each of our schools will have one, possibly two, kindergarten rooms, rooms that are being used for kindergarten that are in the 900 to 950 square foot capacity as opposed to 1,000 to 12, 1,300 square feet. The financial impact, we'll have those calculations put together when Laura gets moving in this process with you. I can tell you at this point, with preliminary estimates we've put together, and I've had my partner double check the numbers and work up our own numbers to see if they look better than mine, we can afford this. Without question, we can afford this all-day kindergarten program. There will be some opportunities to save money in transportation as well. The one thing, and I'll be done here, but the one thing that I have to point out that is really critical to this attendance boundary change process is we need to know how many classrooms we need. So we need to know before we get beyond September, are we going to have the half-day program incorporated with the all-day classroom? Is it going to be a standalone half-day? And if so, is it going to be one at each building or, you know, a half-day program isolated to one building? So that one component is going to be critical for us to continue down this path. And you'll hear more about that when Laura Pierce comes forward on the 26th.
And so you'll bring the options that you mentioned, of course, but you'll have what you are recommending as well?
We will be working on options for the half-day, full-day program. There will be other components that there still will be time, such as supervision for lunchroom, for EAs in the kindergarten classrooms, for specialists and things of that nature. Those don't need to be decided in September in order for this attendance boundary discussion to continue forward. But we do need to know how many rooms we need, and that will be dependent on what that classroom structure looks like.
Okay. Madam Chair?
Yes.
Are we doing any kind of surveying with parents for these incoming kindergartners as to what they're thinking?
You know, I don't think I'm the right person to answer that. I think that discussion has been taking place, and I think, again, you'll hear more about that on the 26th. Okay, thank you.
After we work through the kindergarten criteria, we're going to be working with the different cities and townships, which this is one of the pieces that can move. As we know, when we did our boundary trains last time, the areas that we thought were going to grow the most didn't, and those areas that we didn't think were going to grow grew. So this is kind of our one place that's kind of a shot in the dark, but we do work with them to try to figure out where they're expecting their permits and how much they're expecting, what their comp plans are looking like, and hopefully they can give us some insight to what they're planning for the next several years. Then October 1 rolls around, as that is our first marker for the year where we're looking for the 13-14 school year. With those numbers, we will build what our 14-15, we'll build projections what our 14-15 school year will look like, which will then help with the capacities and making sure that we're getting the right number of kids in the building so we can equalize those buildings out. From there, as we go, we have questions and concerns just like we did last time. You know, what are we going to do? Are we going to grandfather kids in? Do we care about daycare locations? How are we going to handle them? Are we going to try to balance, you know, social economics, our achievement, transportation, open enrollment, walking boundaries? You know, we have all these different moving pieces that we try to fit into this little puzzle and make it work for everybody. We know that we're not going to make everybody happy, but we're hoping to make the majority of the people happy. And then we will come to you with some options for you guys to choose from.
And so the last time we did this, of course, as you just mentioned, we didn't make everybody happy, but for the most part, the feedback was that the school district handled it very well. Mm-hmm. How are you going to go about this time beginning to communicate with the community that we're starting this now so that they know it's coming and can get used to the idea? What are our communication plans?
You know, what we did last time, and not saying that that's the best way, but I thought worked well. We got the committee together, and we kind of put some ideas together on how we wanted to communicate with the community and on an ongoing basis. So last time we had a special module on our website. So at any point in time, someone could go to the website, click on it, and get all the information that they need. They'll have contact information, getting the information out in the newspaper, working with Mr. Skelly and getting communications out, a wide variety. And if anyone has any ideas, that would be great to get out to the community. Please let us know.
Oh, go ahead.
Well, one thing that I don't think was pointed out at the beginning of this, and I probably should have, is that despite the fact that we do have kind of an imbalance in the distribution of our enrollment between our schools, that in itself would justify attendance boundary changes. But the all-day kindergarten, we don't have a choice. If we want to have all-day kindergarten, this is really critical to change these boundaries. Thank you.
I just commented last time, I thought the process went very well. We had the committee present to parents. You know, we had open parent meetings, and we had the committee present that. I think it went over. I mean, there, of course, were some parents that were upset about some of the changes, and you know, when you get down to things, we had to draw some kind of funny little boundaries here and there that you know, divided up neighborhoods, which is unfortunate, but, you know, you relook at several times, and that one seems to make the most sense, but so I think the process went very well last time. It was, you know, very well received. Another comment I would say is that, you know, make sure that we're having those people go to the PTP meetings and things like that so that they can get in with the parents in those meetings as well.
And then I'm just verifying that on some of these things that were, because this wasn't obviously set up for the dates that the committee would be involved. How many of these bullet points are the committee going to actually be deciding versus things that the principals and things? I'm thinking like the family grandfather, and I think like last time it was, I think, a school decision versus that committee. Is that the intent this time as well?
Yes.
Gotcha.
Okay. I mean, but it'll be a school decision, but making sure that the committee agrees with and understands why the school made that decision.
Right.
Are there other questions?
Madam Chair, as far as you talked about an application process to be on that committee, and I would strongly encourage you to send that out via email, whatever, because mm-hmm. I know that there's been other committees and projects, and I think that there's been good representation, but we haven't always communicated how they got pulled together very well. And this is, I think this is a big one, and mm-hmm. I think it's very important that it gets communicated out, the process from the beginning, even selection of, you know, how that committee is being pulled together and whatnot, to ensure that there's good representation across the board and whatnot, and that's the intent. But that if somebody wants to be able to participate, they can go, oh, I remember seeing that, and maybe I should have stepped up if I really wanted to. But, you know, to say that it's
so,
out there.
So you're suggesting email blasts from all the individual buildings to the parents?
To the parents, at least. I mean, I know you're talking community mm-hmm. members, and the district has gotten more involved with, you know, businesses and other opportunities, and I think that there are different groups that we associate with on a regular basis, and I would ask that we kind of reach all those areas just to say, hey, if you're interested, this is how you can participate if interested. But to get that out, clearly we're on a pretty aggressive timeline, so the sooner the better.
Thank you.
Are there other questions?
Madam Chair, just in comment, thinking of the back-to-school open houses, that might be a good place to set out some information regarding that, the boundaries.
Thank you.
Yeah, just a poster along that line soliciting, you know, people to call in or join the committee. You know, give them a chance to see that up front, and then if we can, you know, have the papers help us with an article talking about it and also maybe putting that information out there as well. You guys might get inundated by calls. But I can't believe that would be a totally bad thing in the end. So
we have a finance committee we're still looking for members for.
So we could put a poster up at back to school nights for that, too.
Yeah.
Because I think that sometimes people would be interested, but despite how hard we try, they just have not heard about it. It's because they don't watch the meetings. And maybe they don't read the paper, but if they did know about it, then they would be interested. So maybe back to school night. Conferences, whatever, a poster for the finance committee.
So I need listeners out there. We are still looking for members for the finance committee. Please feel free to call in and talk to Mr. Kohlmark.
Yes. Yes, thank you.
Are there other questions, last comments? Thank you very much. Appreciate your time. Next, we have our enrollment update.
Oh. Well, thank you, Madam Chair. I think we're going to, although they're small numbers, we're still going to project them up, but we did post the updated numbers to Board Book, and I know sent an email to all of you. This is, of course, early to really start talking about actual student numbers of the school year. And when we get our October 1 numbers, we'll have really a full look at the prior years and take a look at trends and that kind of thing. This is more the information that we have now when we start making decisions, especially about class size, try to get a handle on where our budget is really going to be at. Are we coming in at, under, or above? Are we guessing we're going to about what we budgeted for the student numbers? Because, of course, student numbers drives everything for us, the number of, not just the number of staff, but the amount of money that we actually take in as a school district. And I think overall, if I was making an overall comment, we really do have a very positive outlook for enrollment, but it's still very, very, very fluid. So let's take a look. So the first one I have up is the overall numbers, and I do have a little look back because it's kind of cool to look back over last year. And so I have some numbers I'll throw out for you as well. As we go along. So if you see the elementary, the way to read this is the far right column, all in black, is the current numbers, that we have enrolled. And so you can see that there's how many are, so 560, oh, wait a minute.
That's projection.
That's right, that's the projection. And here I know I was going to get that backwards. I even practiced in my head at the time. Because it's the red and the blue. The reason you know that's the actual enrollment is that's saying whether it's above or below. So if it's red, it's below what we're projecting. If it's blue, it's above. And so if you take a look, you can see that, for instance, 542 kindergartners. And so far, we had been projecting 563. But it is still, you know, several weeks before school starts. It's kind of cool to see first grade has 598 students registered. I mean, that's too short of 600. That's a number we've certainly never seen in this school district for a grade. And you really start thinking of a different kind and size of district when you start having, you know, that many students in any one grade. And you can see a very, very solid numbers all through the elementary school. So at this point, we are 20 above projected for And as you know, I sent a note around just a week ago, we were at exactly, we're actually one under projected. So in a week now, we're 20 over. So there are people stopping in every one of our buildings, and lately, especially our middle schools, to register. We've had a lot of registrations, but we'll talk more about that. And then when I look at last year, basically on this date, actually it's a week later when we pulled the numbers last year, we are 31 above where we were in elementary last year. So however things end up, we are 31 now ahead of last year. So that's really a very, I think, a very good thing.
That's for elementary?
That's for elementary.
How do we compare for the second year?
And I'll get to that for each
Sorry.
One. But I know it kind of gets messed up in the mind what that means because there's two, the 20 that were over, that can evaporate. Because students who just don't show up, didn't tell us they weren't coming and don't show up, and we will have those. But it tends to be more or less the same every year. So when you're 31 now, we would expect to be 30 over somewhere down the road. Even if we've lost students, we will expect that. Although it's, I'll talk about that too. There's a caveat to that. So anyway, that's the numbers for elementary. If we look at our middle schools, right now we hit that number of 1,600. Who have registered for our middle schools. That's 800 per middle school, and those are, it wasn't long ago that our middle schools were in the 600s, and so that is really quite a change. You can see a bit of the imbalance there with maybe 100 difference or so between Bachman and Dodge, but that is 44 over what we had projected and really budgeting for. Now again, as we get to upper grades, they tend to be more volatile, and we do tend to lose more students in middle school, and then the most we tend to lose in the high school, who just never told us they weren't coming, and we don't know till they don't show up that first week, so, or we get their records that first week. So anyway, if we look at last year for our middle schools, our middle school enrollment is up 110 versus about this time, middle of August last year. But now that really is a big part, a chunk of that is that's kind of been expected because they have been sending on 400s, numbers in the 400s, and they've been bringing in numbers in the mid to even above mid 500s. So we've known that's happening, but the actual 44 is actual extra students. So that's the reason we came to 110. That's really quite a number to be up. So if you look at the high school, it, we can see 1891 really starting to push. I'm starting to say 1900 students when people ask how big the high school is because we're really pushing that. And it's also interesting to note that they're all in the 400s yet. So the high school hasn't got the Bill's biggest bubble. They're not a bubble. Our new reality is having in the mid 500s or above in students coming into school in each grade level. So our high school will really start growing. We'll be over 2,000 in no time in a couple of years and kind of keep on going at the high school, you know, almost invariably, almost with nothing happening because we just have these bigger classes that'll be moving up. 57 over what we've projected, but that we know that's a number that really can and will drop when the school year starts, but we still like to see it's a very strong number. And it's actually 10 over this time last year. So a slight increase over this time last year. But our high school, you can just tell, we're bringing in kind of the same sort of students that we're exiting, so there's not a big pressure to grow yet. But next year, that'll be totally different. Next year, we're going to see some pretty significant growth when, I take that back. Next year, we will see some growth, but the significant growth will really happen the year after. So as you can see, the final number there, we're 121 over what we've budgeted. But again, well, I'll get to that in a second. We'll mention that we're 151 total over what we were this time last year. So we do see some growth. We had planned for some growth, but there seems to be more growth than we had planned for. But the caveat that you know is, like I mentioned, for all three levels, is we historically have lost 50 to 100 students when the school year starts. Sometime in September, we'll lose 50 to 100. And I think there was one year, not too many years ago, we lost quite a bit over 100 and actually had some budgetary, you know, difficulties because we had kind of planned thinking we were going to lose the 50 to 100 and we lost quite a bit more for whatever reason. Last year, though, I can tell you we only lost 37 from this time until the end of September. We'd only lost about 37. But that's kind of our anomaly. We typically lose 50 to 100. So we're still thinking we're going to lose some, but we also, and by we, actually, these numbers are brand new today. So, and it has significantly changed since last week. So we haven't even talked about them administratively, what this increase means. But I can just say it's really a positive trend. I'm not going to speak or make assumptions about these numbers other than there's more pressure up than there's pressure down right now, and I think it's a good thing. It's a good thing and a thing to celebrate and understand where we are growing. So any questions about kind of the whole K-12 enrollment where we're at?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Is there any tracking to understand why the increases are much higher than anticipated for the secondary level?
You're not in any formal way, no. You know, people do come in and you do ask, you know, why they're coming in. And so as I've been around the buildings, people said, well, because there is building going on that, I mean, it's amazing to go around many areas of our district and see that there is building going on. So there are new families. But there are new families who are choosing to come here who hadn't before as well. So, you know, I don't know. I don't know. It'd be an interesting thing to know. I don't know what it would take to really find out, short of having a real formal, why are you choosing to come here this year, which we probably could and probably would be pretty enlightening. So,
well, we've done historical surveys on why people are leaving the district, mm-hmm. So it would be kind of nice considering all of the iPad initiatives. I mean, if this is what, you know, we providing, the educational tools, the individualized learning, are we really making a district of success for students and successfully getting that information out to surrounding areas? Are these families that were historically always Farmington residents and open enrolled their kids out of the district and are now choosing to bring them back in? Are these families that are outside of the district open enrolling them with, you know, into our district? I think those are things that, as we continue to support some of the changes that we've made in the district, it would be very, very good to know. And I think critical as we get these new families joining the district to potentially an onboarding survey, hey, can you please fill this out to say, you know, information about why you're choosing our district, moved here, you know, whatever. I mean, it could be very simple.
You know, that's right. And one thing that I thought of just more talking to everyone else here is that we have to identify those students more clearly than we did in the past because we have to get them all an iPad. And there's an iPad sign-up night where they all at least, you know, grades 4 through 12 and a couple of third grade classes are going to get them right away. So we have identified who those students are, and it would be kind of cool to, I haven't thought this through, but maybe that'd be the time to kind of ask to say, you know, why is it what brings you to Farmington? So thanks, that's a great thing, and I know we'll be talking about that.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Just while we're briefly speaking about iPads, do we have the capability to handle an increase of 20 students or up to 70 students if historical numbers hold true?
Hold true. Okay. I guess the answer is yes. So I know we do. And I'll say a caveat, one thing, I don't know, I'm probably talking beyond what I know here, but we did certainly last year, we ordered quite a number of extra because thinking we're planning for breakage, and then the breakage wasn't quite we didn't need to have as many as we did for breakage. So I think we do have a number, so.
And I would just also like to agree with Member Singwald that I think it would be very interesting to see why these families are choosing Farmington, and this could even be part of our scorecard we've been talking about in previous meetings. Say, you know, an increase of X percent due to or increased focus on customization.
Wonderful.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
The flip side, looking at just some of the individual grade numbers, it's interesting to me just noticing, looking at kindergarten and seeing that there are three of the schools have significant below projection. Mm-hmm. I'm curious if that might be somewhat related to the all-day K situation, whether they're going elsewhere or if they're just holding back, waiting until they can get the all-day next year. And I'm just curious if we have any information with that. That might play into the consideration of that kindergarten discussion for the future as well as this year.
Thanks. We don't have specific information about that. We were expecting smaller enrollment this year than the last 2 years, just demographically. There were fewer kindergartners coming up, but that's quite a thought. You know, a family that knows that kindergarten is going to be all day, every day for nothing next year, there may well have been a few families who made that choice. I'm going to kind of ask my colleagues from other schools if they're seeing that. And there are other all-day, everyday programs pretty close by that you could go to as well. So.
But you said demographically that's, I mean, because I think it's the eighth grade or the ninth grade this year. There's one year that was in there that we had projected, and it ended up just being a no baby year. And so we were anticipating a lot more students than what showed up in kindergarten. It wasn't that they were choosing not to come in the district.
Yep.
It was just a low birth year, I guess. But
seems to be the big case, yeah.
I think it is the ninth graders coming in, because that's my daughter's grade, and we discussed that on the boundaries committee.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, I think, you know, I've, in light of what's happening in school districts all around us and how high their class sizes have gone, I'm just thrilled to see how great these numbers look. And I feel very fortunate that we're able to do this. You know, some of the classes that are high and that the administration's allocated a 0.5 towards to help with those high numbers, if those continue to go up a little bit, do you anticipate that you'll take some more action on those numbers?
Yes, and I'll put it up there as well so people could see, but I do. The one thing that's different now about this year, and we learned that it really last year as well, that it is now that we see all of our elementary students, because we do the assessments of them, or either you've talked to them and you've assured that they're coming, our elementary numbers, if you see the whites of their eyes and have met with them, you know they're coming. So instead of having to wait to the school year to really see what's happening, I think by the 21st, 22nd, when we kind of have those meetings, I think we'll be able to know then. And absolutely. And even now, you know, if the numbers go up at all, because we're really pushing. I'll just kind of take a quick look at the numbers for some of those who maybe haven't looked. That well, first I won't really look at Aiken Road, because Aiken Road is just a packed school, you know, and so it doesn't really have classroom space to have. So you can see it has strong student numbers just about everywhere. Although the one thing, there is 32 students per grade at fifth, and they have a 0.5, so they spend half of their day basically at about 27 and the other half at 32. And we've really had a focus of really taking care of K-2 first. And so you can see that they do have they have 25 students, strong 25, and even above that in first grade. If I take a look at Farmington Elementary.
But before you move on.
Sure.
So you're saying for Aiken Road, you know, the 27 in first grade? And the 32 and 5th, the reason we can't act on that is because of space?
Yes.
And that's something we're hoping to alleviate with the boundary.
That's exactly right.
All right.
that's why we were having this conversation that we need to do the boundaries maybe even before the kindergarten thing came up.
Okay.
Is because they're doing nothing but growing. You six sections of first grade, and they're still not, you know.
That's the most.
And they're
right?
still
of
large.
Schools.
So
six sections.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, and I think that's concerning too. I mean, like, say if you were to add another section, you'd still be within the range of the class size recommendation.
Sure.
You know, those are pretty big classrooms for first graders, and
yes.
I realize the space is probably an issue there.
Yeah.
You know, but if we can relook that anyway, I mean, that's so hard on those little kids and on the teachers at that
yeah.
age to have that many kids in there, and you hate kids get lost in the shuffle, and we have the iPads that they're acclimating to, and just a lot of challenges with a class size like that.
Yeah. And maybe if they could find a space for a 0.5 or something, where for half the kind of the academic part of the day, I just don't know. I guess we'll let the principal there, Lisa, get her feet wet and those kind of things, and I'll talk to her about that as well.
Thank you.
So, anything else about that one? You can see the class size. Yes, the class size, kind of the management on the side where we try to keep between 20 and 25 in K through 2. Although we're happy with kindergarten classes that are even a little smaller. You can't have too many first and second grade classes too close to that 20, or you just really become budget busting. But you can see we're doing a pretty nice job of having, pretty full without having over full first grade. And second grade, there's just a lot of every other school is having difficulty with having more second graders than they are staffed for. I have to mention, though, when it comes to elementary, that while we're right now, my numbers show that we're 20 over, which probably means we're pretty close to even. We're pretty close to the budgeted number, so we don't have additional dollars from our elementary allocation. We did allocate for this number of students, but students do just end up, they don't all come in the right numbers. You end up having highs and lows. And so this year it is our second grade. So if you look at second grade at FES, they have 28 and 29 kind of for half the day, and then about 23 right now for half the day. And so you try to make, again, that good academic part of the day and try to have them at 23. And there's different ways. I'll just say that's the way we put the numbers, but principals and staffs deal with that halftime differently in different buildings and how they actually use it. If you, Meadowview, again, 28s and 27s. And so the in my mind right now, the plan is to add a 0.5 to Meadowview no matter what. And you give me some feedback on that. But they aren't much lower than the 28s in like FES and in North Trail. Well, North Trail now is up to, 29 on average. So we are actually getting to the range where I'm uncomfortable all the time with a couple of the class sizes. But if I'm uncomfortable with one, I'm probably uncomfortable with them all. And that is an additional 2 FTE, which would be about $120,000+. And if there's no additional revenue for that, it can be a difficult decision. But I don't want students to have a bad day. And part of it is funny, but people think more about you from your highest than your average. I think, as Chair Lee had kind of indicated, it's again, just looking at these numbers, it's really a celebration. If we look at all of our, colleagues and what the class sizes they do put up with, so there's some magic here or something that we're able to keep them the way they do look. So, an additional 2 FTE to really make it K through 2, I don't know. It's probably be a difficult decision, but we'll watch the numbers. And you can certainly give me feedback tonight, but also you can, anytime you want, privately give me feedback too. And others are as well. I'm hearing from other people as well. So, and I do appreciate that.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Just a thought, and looking at those high numbers at Aiken are troubling, knowing their space capacity and knowing that we're looking into the boundary discussion. I wonder if there's any way we can kind of think outside of the box and see if maybe a couple families might be willing to open enroll to another building to help alleviate the the capacity at Aiken. However, that would also change the numbers at the other buildings, and all of the classes are pretty much at capacity. But just thinking of maybe there's some ways to kind of try to help those numbers or look at ways the building is used to just try to, I don't know. Yeah. It's a tough spot we're in right now, and it's difficult looking at those numbers. I feel for those parents.
Yeah.
And I would like to really emphasize, you know, I got the opportunity to see spreadsheet just like this for other districts last year. I won't mention who. Our numbers are so great overall. I'm really proud of us for holding strong on these. But I do still feel a little sick to my stomach when I see the kindergarten first and second grade numbers creep up, and even fifth grade at Aiken, yeah, so high. So if there is a way that we can figure out to help it, I would like to see us try to do that.
Thank you.
And in whatever way that is, I mean, I don't know, yeah, but I just thank you and appreciate it very much that you are looking at them and taking it seriously as well. I think we all appreciate that.
Well, thanks for that. I do want to also point out, I did talk to the principal at North Trail today too, and they have third graders. They have a pretty solid 30. You know, that's two over the numbers. So, and right now we haven't done anything with them, but we really try to focus first on K through two. You know, and so, but we'll see. And hopefully in the next couple weeks too, we'll still have a better idea where we'll end up with financially with the numbers. You know, but in the end too, I didn't bring it up because we hadn't gotten here yet, but when we talk about next year and the ability to generate even a little bit more revenue for our students, you know, it's, you know, helps this as well, because we can't serve both. We can't always, you know, minimize our revenue and then still manage to keep class size where we want it to be, and the state to give us some opportunity to help, I think, keep where we're going. The other thing is in the secondaries, you know, they would like us to have them more part of our thoughts and our conversation, maybe even at the board level and policy level. Right now, their middle schools, you know, are kind of that 30-31 on average, which is, and that's on average, so students aren't seeing classes much smaller than that, and they are seeing up to, you know, 34, you know, and you get 34 seventh graders in the same room together, you know, I mean, there's all kinds of things they can also do to manage that, and we're trying to rethink school and all of that, and they do get that too, but that's difficult, and people do compare high schools, you know, and so if you start having classes in your high schools that stretch up to 40, people do start thinking of you differently as well. So it's all grades.
Well, and I was going to ask about the secondary next, and wondering two things. First of all, you know, our plan to redesign how we do school, would that help? You know, we talked about just some passing conversations at some retreats and some other conversations that I can't pinpoint right now, sure, about how we could even put students for a lecture into the auditorium and then split them up into smaller class sizes for more one-on-one with the teacher, just different ways of designing school with, you know, with the customized learning. And then also, now that this will be the first year, I guess, so it will be sort of a test where when students go on in August to pick up their schedules, they also can get their iPad.
Yeah.
So will that make more students show up on that day? Historically, do we have a lot of students show up on those early days so that we know for sure they're coming?
Oh,
like we do for elementary?
Yeah, that's right too, if we have...
Because my son just cannot wait for Thursday because he gets his iPad back. He's just jumping up and down about it. So he wouldn't miss it no matter what, mm-hmm, you know? And so I'm thinking if other families are that excited that they're more likely to flock to this day, mm-hmm, and then we know for sure they're coming.
That's right. That's a great thought. We'll monitor all of that and have those conversations. So.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
One of the schools you didn't talk about was Riverview, and some of their numbers look different compared to the other four elementaries because they have, my understanding is, the blended...
Yes.
Grade level, so two, you know, 1-2 together, 3-4 together. Is there any talk about what kind of successes that building's seen with those classrooms and opportunities at the other buildings? Because when you're looking at a grade 3 of 30 and a grade 4 of 26, if they had a classroom that had an opportunity for a 3-4 in that building, it might allow for more flexibility. And so I'm just curious as far as what talk throughout the district as we move forward of opportunities may have been seized at some buildings, and is that being shared and discussed even?
Thank you.
I think that could solve some of the
bubbles. That's a great question.
Easily every year.
Yes, great question. I'll maybe kind of reflect, because I did talk to Kim, the principal of Riverview, you know, just recently, a little bit about that. And we have talked about it administratively, because, yes, absolutely, that gives her a lot of flexibility. You know, it's easy to save an FTE or more without ever feeling it, because you start really blending those classes, and the high ones and the lower grades, the grades that have lower numbers per class can start getting blended. But the other side of that coin is you really kind of wanna. And so for her, she's built excitement among her teachers, and it's her teachers who come to her and say they wanna do this, they wanna do this. And so now she does have four of those blended classrooms, and probably will continue to grow. There's a waiting list for all those classrooms, which is really nice, which also has this added benefit we usually don't think about, is they become choice programs. And so you can drive as many students in there as people will. You can have that top number. That's part of the savings in the numbers. So whatever number it is that you want in that class, you can drive into that class. So I think it's like 27 on average, 27 and a half on average that she has in those four classes. And people are very happy. They still are on a waiting list to be in those classes at that number. So there is some... So there is some really nice things about it. So yes, it is a great tool to be used, can be used by other schools, but I do find you weaken it when it's only used as a tool where, okay, this year we're gonna have these grades, this year we're gonna have these grades, because it's just wherever you have it that it happens. If it has to be more systematic. So like having four in your school is just gonna help overall. So,
right.
So yes, I would like to see more of that.
I mean, you've got a professional group now who's done this for a couple of years who can potentially be working with these other buildings, just like, I mean, there's some single subject teachers amongst buildings that still get together and collaborate to some degree, and I would really like to see our district continue to work, not so much silos, mm-hmm. but, you know.
Thank you.
And I did.
Bidirectionally.
Thank you.
I did have a conversation with her when I did my board walk there and got to see the classrooms in action. And one thing she did point out, though, sort of the flip side of this choice in the waiting list, is having the choice go the other way for the parents that do not want that and they want the traditional classroom as well. And she was very concerned about keeping both options in her building so that parents could still be where they were most comfortable for their students. But I still think it'd be a great thing to explore expanding into other buildings.
That would really help us.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
So I kind of going back to these numbers, like I say, I think there's, you know, probably four or five pockets of concern in these numbers. And I know that we've said that the budget's an issue, and obviously, you know, this would increase costs, but this was also one of our budget parameters. And, you know, I mean, I feel like, do we have other things on the table? I mean, if this materializes like this, do we have other things on the table that we can look at balancing the need for teachers with potential other cuts?
Right, we had a larger list of potential budget cuts last year than we actually approved, so maybe we could do some trading, so to speak.
There are some things, and there are some things we can do immediately this year that, you know, wouldn't amount to the amount that we needed, but I always think of these things as the years go, and if we're looking ahead to maybe a significant improvement in our resources next year, it may be that we can do something this year, knowing that next year when you do our budget, we'll have to pay for it, you know, so there are things that we can do that way, and take a look at all those things, and I'll definitely come back with more at the next meeting when we're all up here. You know, that'll be a time when I'll be able to maybe announce some of those things, and again, if you have private thoughts or other thoughts about it, you feel free to give me a call, or I guess more than we'll talk about here tonight, or if you have anything or you hear from someone, you know, let me know, but we'll watch it, and there's some of these numbers are becoming, fairly concerning to us. You know, again, it's, you know, other districts, this wouldn't even be, it would be one of their nicer classes, some of our bad ones, but we do have a real strong belief in that, so.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
One more piece, in considering the secondary classes, and
in the discussion with the Innovation Zone and our partnership with Spring Lake Park, we had talked about classes combining with Spring Lake Park, some distance learning. Is there any of that in play for the next year that might help some of these sizes?
Maybe for the next school year, that's right. That's kind of what this year is about, seeing what we can come up with some of those things. And, you know, whether those will actually be budget savings as more just more opportunities for kids. We'll see. You know, we'll see. There is some real opportunities there, and partly there is some opportunities for additional resources and, you know, through that as well, who people want to help us develop these kind of programs and things too. But, I think there will be some, you know, for next year. I think it's part of our, matter of fact, it'd be part of our evaluation of it. You know, we have those areas where you're supposed to evaluate and send updates to the Department of Ed, and that's one of them. You know, what has this saved us? So, thanks.
Okay. But, and so for the secondary, so even if it was budget neutral, if it didn't actually save us money, but it sort of alleviated some of the higher numbers because they are in a separate room doing distance learning,
yes,
in like part,
yes,
something that's beneficial to the students and to the teachers of the secondary,
yes,
regardless of whether or not it's a budget savings, it's still then a benefit.
That's right. That's a great way to look at it. That might be fewer kids in the classroom,
yes,
because they're doing something else.
And yes.
So.
That's what I was alluding to,
yep,
in my question.
Thank you. Right. Well said. Thank you.
Any other questions or discussion? Great. Next, we have our policy review.
Okay. Once again, thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board, and the audience. This is kind of our ongoing efforts. There it is. You know, to update our budget and to just roll it all over to MSBA, who again constantly updates their policies. These two as well, the 300 series and the 400 series. Are the changes are pretty much in title and some of the organization of things, but everything is still covered that was you know, covered in our current policies. This I don't know how much time you spent looking through all of them, but I wanted to lay them on the table for you tonight and say that we'll come back, I suppose, at the next work session and have you know, the people who are, you know, available to answer questions about these items. On the other hand, I guess if you do look through them, this is pretty much a, what's the word I'm looking for? It is just a replacement of what we're currently doing. There's no real significant changes, unless someone has something in mind. I don't think there's any. As I look through them all, there's no real significant changes. It's just getting them in the MSBA numbering system.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
On the discipline, suspension, and dismissal of school district employees, does that apply to union employees as well as other district employees, non-union employees?
It does, but of course, there's depending on the union contract, there's a different process in there, and there may be some other language that controls this as well. Usually, if it's in a contract, it's even further control. This is kind of the broad overarching policy for all people.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions?
Madam Chair, I just have a comment. I want to thank you guys again for all of your work on these policies because it is tedious, very tedious work. And I personally appreciate the correlation of this is what it was, this is what it is. It just clearly outlined, and for anybody watching, I know there were hours put into this, and so I want to recognize that. Thank you.
Thank you, and thanks everyone who helped with this.
Any further discussion on that then? Then I'll take a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn at 7:44.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Cordes. All in favor?
Aye.
This meeting's adjourned.